love art. I like to use words like cheers. I like to use words like rather. I like to use words about law. I like to use words about law. With Matt. I like to kick back with Joe. My mind turns straight to art. Teeny boppers. I really hate losing card games. But I just think back to art. And I'm happy once again. Do I love art more than law? 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 Cheers. I like to use words like rather. I like to use words about law. I like to use words about law. I like to hang out with Matt. I like to kick back with Joe. My mind turns straight to art. Teeny boppers. I really hate losing card games. But I just think back to art. And I'm happy once again. Do I love art more than law? Do I love art more than law?
Do I love art more than law? Cheers.
Hi guys. So it was quite incredible talk as for me. Like I feel that we'll have a lot of questions. Thank you, Doris. Like you made this amazing video, and how I know Marco also will like trying to join us soon. And
he's here, Marco.
Okay, super. So, like Dennis was just amazing video. And and thanks guys, our audience that like you're waiting for us, and now we have this good possibility like to ask the questions. We already got a few of them during the video, so now Alexandra and Stas will help us with like moderating of the questions. And also please, like, if you have any more questions, please write them in the comments, because now we have this perfect time to talk more about the post photography. Okay, thanks. So I'm giving the word to the questions.
Hi everyone, hope you see me hear me okay. Yeah, do you hear me, Doris, Mark?
Yeah, everything's okay. Fine.
Thank you for this post lecture about post photography, and I can't help but ask the question that was on the screen actually: is photography over or not?
Marco, do you want to answer that one? Well, I'm playing with my cat.
Sure. No, I don't know. I think that I think that photography as an obsession with itself being over. So I think some sort of syndrome that photography has. You know, it's photography is both over and more alive than ever, right? It's always these two poles that we hear in the narratives of photography institution. Like, we cannot deal with the fact that it's a medium in constant transition, transformation since it was born, right? So if we go back at the history of photography, we always look at all of these, even technical processes that keep changing over time.
Yeah, maybe we can say the traditional understanding of photography is over. But photography, I mean, if you look around and if you look at what you're doing right now, being at home, stuck to your screens, you can see that you are involving in so many image-based photographic forms of practice on a daily basis. And the photographic actually is still the most dominant mode of our contemporary times. So there is this extreme flourishing and expansion of happening to photography, and the way we think about it and our understanding of it, of course, also has to adapt to this expansion and to try to include these different kinds of notion that can be termed photographic, which also Marco in his chapter was referring to when he was talking about seeing machines, for example, this concept proposed by Trevor Paglen.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Alexander, have you found any from the comment section? Yeah.
We have a question to our beautiful banana. So do you feel that as a digital curator, you are more prepared to the new normal than any person less experienced with network reality? And then we'll have two more questions related to curator activity as well.
Sorry, could you repeat it if I'm more worried about?
Do you feel that as a digital curator, you are more prepared to the new normal than any person less experienced with network reality?
I don't know if I'm more prepared. Like, I don't think that. I think that it's definitely, you know, like, I've been investigating online spaces and online platforms before, and I've been investigating many of the images, of course, that we talked about in our talk. So in that sense, yes. But in terms of being prepared, is personally, it's not like I felt like, woohoo, yeah, I'm really glad, you know, this lockdown and all of this. I don't know. But yeah, I was excited to see many responses and many institutions and artists kind of reacting to these limitations in a way. So in that sense, I was maybe not, I don't know if prepared is the right word, but I had something that I was looking forward, you know, to get out of this, and something that kind of excited me from seeing like all of these reactions in terms of both photography institution, photographers, and artists at large.
So we have another question related to this, basing maybe on your experience. What would be your advice for curators? What to start with in order to adapt to this new reality and to work with it? So the question is about the start. What to start with for curators in this digital world?
Hmm. Doris, do you have any advice for curators?
Well, I think the question was addressed to you. Being, but I mean, what could we do? I think this is what we have tried to do, or at least what I have tried to do now in this presentation, which was for me something completely new. I'm the research curator at Fotomuseum. I usually work very text-based, more in an academic style. And all I can say, like for curators, is explore, experiment, use what you have at home, use the screen, use the possibilities, use the Snapchat filters, and just play with them and see what kind of creative things you can come up with. I think this is exactly the time where everyone kind of also has this freedom to explore and see what could work and what doesn't, because it is becoming the new normal, but so many people are inexperienced in how to go about. So this is the time to explore.
Maybe what I can say from my side is also work with the limitations. So I'm thinking of, I've mentioned at the beginning of the talk that we launched a new format together with the Photographer's Gallery called Screen Walks, which explore artists who work with the screen and appropriate images which are digital, born digital, or anyway come from online spaces. Of course, you know, like many photographic images that were uploaded on eBay or Craigslist. Those are photographs which are then digitized, and then artists like Penelope Umbrico appropriate them and use her in her work. So, and then the second talk was, of course, the opposite thing was Alan Butler looking at images who are born in the digital world, or born digital, like CGI, and then he extracts them and maybe does cyanotypes with them. So, you know, like if you look at all of these spaces that happen online, in the context of photography, this limitation can actually help curators to find new artistic practices and new artists who work with the medium, or somehow also a bridge between different media that involve photography.
And here comes our next question, actually it's for the same person as the previous one. Can you compare the curating of post-photography and post-art in general?
No.
If there is any particular difference?
I cannot compare.
Doris?
The post-photography...
And post-art.
Photography and post-art. I can also not. Post-art. I guess when you have the post, it kind of indicates a similar shift when you look at the various types of posts. So I guess it would be dealing with similar aspects, but I couldn't, no, go more in detail.
Okay, I found another question in the comment section. Has the lockdown influenced the number of post-photography projects? The question may be both for both of you.
Hmm. I think it might be early to tell. Although from what I've seen, there's been lots of, I don't know if they're all post-photography projects, but there's been quite a few projects that I think were quite interesting. I'm thinking of Laura McCarthy's new project, which we featured in our situation program. Although in her new project about the pandemic, which was quite specific to the situation of the lockdown, it's very text-based, so it's not really post-photographic or image-based. But I think, especially now with lots of funding as well that are coming out. Here in Switzerland, we had a dedicated funding for the restricted mobility. So we can probably see how that will influence also photographers in the work. So, you know, the whole infrastructure that connects the institutions, the artists, and the fundings, I think will be impacted by this. So I will expect to see more and more post-photographic projects.
Probably now we've seen like a first phase, right? Where many institutions also were kind of trying to take what they had planned for the physical space and kind of bring it to an online audience. So we've seen a lot of live streams, I guess, of things that were actually meant for the space and then were live streamed on Instagram. So kind of more classical forms. And I guess the second phase will maybe then bring more this kind of experimental nature to really explore the spaces that we can make art in and work with the medium we have, which is not in a physical space, but which is actually an online reality.
Mm-hmm. And going to this AI topic, how can we distinguish between a human and machine-created photo? Is there any algorithm, for example, in the issue with deepfakes? So maybe again for both of you. Do you know any algorithm that can be used to distinguish the difference? Was the photo made by a human or by a machine?
I think that, I'm trying to be serious here, Doris, don't make me laugh. I think that the problem of fake has been also something that happened right long time before deepfakes, right? There are definitely technologies and ways that you can compare the different like light sources and all of this. I think if you check on our Still Searching blog, there's actually an interesting series that talks exactly about that, and it's quite technical too, so it gives a few insights in how to spot a fake. But then of course, you know, like after deepfakes we also had neural networks, and you know, just last year and most recently the creation of GAN, generative adversarial networks, who create images that are completely photorealistic, and we will be quite indistinguishable from ones created through a camera. So I think that in that sense, I'm betting on, I'm gonna give up on trying to have a solid way to distinguish a fake from the real, if we're talking about like a technical standpoint. But maybe that, I don't know, I like to think that's also liberation, right? Like maybe we can stop believing in images altogether. Because maybe before, this illusion was kind of easier for us to fall in, right? You had this sense of having an image which was somehow depicting an objective truth, which was of course also very problematic. And now with this trust crumbling because of more sophisticated way to fake an image, maybe we can just stop believing in images altogether.
But don't we put the photojournalists on the threat in this point of view, from this point of view?
I guess here the question becomes important to ask, like, in what context do we need to pay more attention to this, right? In what context does it become relevant if a picture is created by a human being or by a machine? And then, of course, the picture usually also, especially when you talk about photojournalism, the picture does not stand alone, right? So there in photojournalism, there are so many kind of rules and regulations on how a picture is made and then how it goes to the photo agency and how it lands in a newspaper. And there are so many human beings involved. It's not a process that is completely delegated to algorithms and machines, but it's actually a very human-based process, which is which has much to do with trust. So I think there are so many rules and structures in place that we don't need to worry that much about these questions.
Mm-hmm. And actually in this context we have a question from Anna. She asks, and it's quite long, so be prepared guys. With all the open sourced images that represent multiple perspectives of witnessing in conflict zones, just like images that forensic architecture gained from people who were on site at the time of accident in question, would you say that there is still room for professional war zone photography and conflict journalism? And is there a need for encouragement for such type of photography by different World Press Awards, etc.?
So in terms of photojournalism and war photography, I think it's quite interesting. Right before we closed the museum, we opened an exhibition of war female photographers, and we spent some time trying to look at the development of this figure over the last few decades. And it's interesting. We've seen the rise of photography, of citizen photographers, right? And with the mobiles in the tents and so, and then we've seen like in Abu Ghraib, for example, the role of the whistleblowers leaking the images, and now we've been looking, of course, at the most recent cases in Syria and Aleppo with social media platforms and delivering like a this sort of content again from a even more frequent and personal point of view. So I think it's not so much about, the death of a profession or like something that is doomed to not to exist anymore because of this this problem of truth or fake, but rather like the opening of a profession to a series of many different possible photographers and war photographers. So the stakeholders, like the voices, are much wider, and there's not just this figure of the war photographer who goes on the scene with or against the military or the government that it's accompanying on the field. So in a way, I think, I don't know if that answers the question, but I think one thing to keep in mind is that once again, the transformation of the media also led to a transformation of the role of the war photographer, I would say. So it's just a much more complicated network of stakeholders, once again, that goes, from the blurring of the boundaries between the viewer, the participant, and the photographer, and the subject that has been of the conflict. So many of the things that are embedded, of course, in the discourses of forensic architecture's practice as well.
And yeah, I also think, as Marco says, things usually not, the one doesn't completely go in the place of the other, but usually they coexist, right? The photo industry is quite a big thing, and it's gonna find its way, and it's gonna find its different forms. I think there was a second part of the question connected to the world press.
Yeah, so is there is a need to encourage such type of photography, like war photography, by these awards systems like World Press?
I mean, I generally find it quite problematic with World Press awards, I mean, you get into this question of the aestheticization of people in crisis, and I find the standards that are applied, like looking at the quality of an image, looking at the image kind of being beautiful, that's already kind of a problem per se when we talk about conflict and war photography. So I, for me personally, the World Press would not be the place I would invest in when it comes to encouraging young photographers to go to war. I mean, why do you want to go to war? Why do you want to risk your life and document or pay witness to people dying? I don't think that making a beautiful image should be the encouragement for that.
Yeah, and also, if I can add a comment, I think the World Press Photo has been struggling to find a way to keep this sort of ethical questions by adding lots of technical implementation that resulted in almost as a real ridiculous standard where, even at the level of what they accept, right? They have to be JPEG, non-manipulated, or there is like an online on the WordPress photo a series of rules where they explain what is allowed and what is not allowed. Like a certain degree of manipulation is allowed, but it's not allowed to Photoshop content. But sometimes, like if you look at rule by rule, it's obvious that these kind of rules will never catch up with the core of the problem, and they're only trying to kind of be a sort of almost like an algorithm, paradoxically, you know, like they try to deal with questions of ethics of the photographer by reducing the technicalities of what can be accepted as a photograph and what is not. So I think a different approach needs to be implemented, and it should be something that, as Doris said, it requires like people to come together and discuss, because ethics and morality are issues that cannot be devised by a series of rules. Like we're streaming on Facebook, like on a Facebook you know, algorithm for censorship of what images is allowed and what is not. And I think the WordPress photo is actually following the same path. So I have a bit of a problem with that in that sense.
Okay, and as we're talking about this traditional kind of photography, I can't help but mention the question of Vera. If we have so many digital content and so many broadcasts, maybe we should pay more attention to this traditional classic photography. It's less like a comment. And the question is, what is your attitude to traditional and analog photography? Would it come to the masses again, or will it be just like an old school? I think Marco maybe has the answer.
Yeah,
I'm okay, though.
Thoughts?
Sorry, yeah, I was
you were changing mask.
Yeah. No, I don't know. I don't understand the first part of the question. Like,
it was more like a comment, maybe. Maybe we should pay more attention to classic photography, as we have so many digital and digital content now.
I find it really funny, because I usually find myself like, you see, like, okay, I think we've paid enough attention to traditional photography. You know, like, I think traditional photography has lots of space. And I always, but of course, that comes with my job and my interest, of course. I find that, you know, it's quite interesting to include traditional photography in our reflections on what's happening now. But I find that it's more the case that institutions resist more contemporary transformation of the image and look and privilege the tradition of photography in terms of the exhibitions and what their activities are. So I don't agree too much with the first comment, but once again, it might be also because of what I deal with in my job. And the second part, what was the question again?
It was, what is your attitude to traditional analog photography? Do you think it will come back to the masses, or it will be just an old school?
No. Actually, you know, we've seen a big comeback in processes that are even pre-photographics. I don't know if you've seen also, what was the Back to the Future exhibition last year, 2 years ago at the FOM at Theo Berlin, with artists going back to analog processes. Of course, one of the things to mention is that these processes are easier to be accepted by the market, especially, you know, I mentioned cyanotypes, which create unique artworks. So there is also that drive. And on the other side of this question is the fact that because many institutions have not been able to deal with digital online post-photographic form of the network image, it's also hard. There are not many models for artists to work in the same way when it comes to selling their works or markets and collectors. So I do think that traditional photography and analog processes are still going to be actually quite strongly used by many artists, and we've seen it a lot. I mean, if we go to photography fairs, I think that we see an abundance of these processes.
Yeah, maybe if I can add here again, I think this is very common that we have this analog digital divide, right? It's either one or the other. And I think it's kind of time to stop thinking maybe about that like that and start kind of seeing it as things coexisting, and both things or all things kind of having their validity. And I mean, if we talk about the comeback maybe of analog photography, I mean, photographic institutions are built on an understanding of analog photography. I think that it does not come too short when we talk about the institutionalization of photography and how we understand, or how traditional institutions understand photography. This is all based on analog concepts and analog understandings. And I mean, the collections of photography are all built more or less on collecting analog photography. So I don't think we have to be kind of afraid that this is going to go away. This is also a historical heritage that we have the duty to take care of and continue to bring to the future. So in that sense, I think both should coexist, and we should find and enjoy the best of both.
And actually, I continue the discussion, but from a different perspective. As you mentioned, analog photography, it is, we're used to this photography, and it is quite clear how to earn money by this. And we have a question now, how can the digital projects funded? Because if we speak about the person who funds money, such persons likes to have a measured impact. And it is more difficult to provide this impact with post-photographic projects and online exhibitions. So what are the future of this in terms of commercial aspect?
Well, in terms of impact, I have to say that for us, you know, we also mentioned this at the beginning of our talk. We are a museum in Winterthur, which is a small town in Switzerland. It's 100,000 people there. So in terms of having a global impact, and maybe also the reason why you contacted us or you know about us, is probably more because of our blog or our situations program, our online activities. And even now, like the screen walks format that we launched had a very good turnout and a very good response in terms of people, which can be measured quite more, even more effectively because of the, you know, registrations and signups and all the people that you can see on Zoom and in the live stream. So again, I'm not quite sure that I agree with this idea that it's harder to measure the impact. I think that it's probably harder to find, or we've been thinking about try to find sources of income maybe for the institution, because we're offering, of course, all of these platforms for free. But that's, I think, a general question when it comes to, you know, like even like newspapers and other online, other processes that have moved online and have tried to monetize or change like their systems of income. So, you know, like paywalls, donations, all of these schemes are possibilities. I think we're lucky enough that we still believe that we should, you know, offer this content and get people to have the knowledge of transfer, the transfer of knowledge, sorry, for free. But maybe, you know, digital membership or other possibilities could be something interesting to explore.
Okay, Stas, do you have questions?
Yeah, I found a nice question from Max in this comment section again. What is considered as the original copy in these digital projects that you have shown or any other of post photography, and how copyright is regulated in network practices?
So how copyright is regulated? There is no answer for that, in the sense that, well, different nations have different standards. There's not a global standard, while the internet is kind of global. There is, of course, a precedent in art with appropriation art, so, you know, and artistic transformation and all of that. But most importantly, I think for us, is the fact that we want, or we believe that vernacular images and practices are very important and should be considered by museums. And some of the interesting things that are happening with the image right now are not even created by artists, but maybe are created by people who are making memes, or by scientists who are creating a different way to use technology that reveals something about the medium, which interests us on a cultural level. So how to deal with that legally is an interesting question, but it's also a minefield that kind of gets in the way. So the way that we deal with this is we're really not caring about it. Or at least I shouldn't speak on behalf of the institution. We should say that we are using this as some sort of research. So we're doing a research on cultural phenomena. So we're using these images as kind of a proof and something that contextualizes our research and our ideas.
So, there were no legal issues so far, yeah?
So far, no, I don't think so. Doris, was there any legal issue?
No.
Don't sue us, please.
I think the good thing about putting things online is also you can usually, like, especially if we put something online on our institutional website, you can contact us, right? And then you can have a discussion and you can take it down. That's kind of the good thing, right? It's not like a book that's published and it's being circulated. You can take it down. Of course, if the image or whatever, the content has already recirculated on the internet and spread, then of course it's really hard to get it out of the system. But otherwise...
But actually, I think, you know, I was of course joking when I said that we don't care, because in a sense, we really care about this in the sense that we are doing this knowingly and making also a case for it, because we think that this copyright thing, it makes no sense in many cases when we are taking some content and recontextualizes as a museum, obviously. So we're not stealing, because copyright would be problematic in the moment that I steal an image and I try to take credit and make money off it, and saying that it's mine, right? Like trying to pass it as one of my works. And that's of course not something that we're doing. We're taking images where, in case of memes, for example, the authorship is so difficult to trace that they become something that even for the law is something that is very difficult to extricate, to disentangle from this whole network of circulation.
And of course, we also think about what it means for copyright in a much wider sense. If you think that photography has a very long tradition and photographers going somewhere, taking images of people without their consent and then getting money for these images and receiving a copyright for something that they have not done just on their own, right? Ariella Azule writes about photography being an encounter and photography being an act, a collaborative act in which many people participate. And copyright is actually very much tailored to just this notion that the person who takes the photo gets the right. But there is, of course, also this can be challenged as well.
And there is a question concerning this topic we are discussing now. Can it be the photography without any author at all?
I think that we can definitely find many situations where authorship is very difficult to find. Like, where would you attribute the authorship to the license plate recognition cameras or the ones which are taking picture of speeding vehicles? When you get a fine, when you're driving by the highway and you're getting too fast and you get a photo, right? Like these same machines that Trevor Paglen speaks of reveal this entangled network of stakeholders between human and non-human actors. So this authorship might be not nobody, but it's definitely not somebody who's easily attributed. Remember also, we spoke about technology, but of course non-human actors are also animals. The long dispute with the case of the monkey selfie and all of these other things, right? Just reveal how much we resist this idea that there should be a human author, but at the same time also reveals that the authorship idea is much more complicated than what we kind of established legally and in our mindset historically. Also, I mean, the pigeons with cameras attached on them, the small cameras in the 30s or so, the first recognized aerial photography experiments, right? Who is the author? Is the pigeon, is the camera? Or even the discussion at the very beginning of photography with this dispute about whether the photograph was made by the sun, the apparatus, the photographer, and all of these things. I think this notion of authorship has always been very kind of blurry and muddled and without an easy solution.
Okay.
Yeah, let us check the list of questions.
Yeah, I have a question. It's just from a bit different domain than we have discussed so far. It's about environment, ecology issue. Question from Max. What carbon footprint do digital shots have? So he means, how does contemporary photography influence environment?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I think in one of the chapters, one of the tips that we did, we talked exactly, or we mentioned in passing, right, in the what was it? I think chapter 2 or 3. Anyway, we talked about the infrastructure of digital photography and the digital and network image as being something very material. So if you think about, you know, these images on Zoom and on Facebook and the servers and the circulation through this, I mentioned the channels that go undersea, and as well as all the infrastructure that connects your screen to your internet, to your hard drive, and all of the circulation globally that support the system of the network image. We're talking about a very, very big impact on the environment. I don't remember the exact number, so I don't want to say what percentage is it. I should have remembered, I'm sorry. But it's actually something that we've seen also growing quite increasingly in the last few weeks because of the lockdown. So I think it's also, you know, something that is going to affect more and more, like the earth, when we talk about post photography and the network image, of course.
Let me check if there are any other questions. There's a great question from Inga. Will traditional methods of presentation in physical museums and galleries change in the context of new forms of photography and art? How do you see this post museum or post gallery?
Doris, you want to take this? I mean, I can keep on going, but I think you should also
shine. I think it's quite a tricky question, because once again, we are saying that this post museum will have to incorporate many different kinds of forms, right, and many different kinds of practices. So it's kind of hard to imagine very concretely what that could be, but I guess it would be something that is not tailored specifically to one physical space, right? But something that kind of happens also in distributed forms and network forms. Maybe the network image can actually be kind of a guide or a model in terms also of how to think this post museum, this post institution.
Yeah, and I think maybe, you know, just because we've worked on our situations program for the last 5 years, that's something that could be interesting if people want to take a look and how we've tried to kind of experiment outside of the traditional exhibition format. So trying to, again, not just decide for online versus physical, but rather try to mix the two and see what experiments could be done by not merging, using the two spaces with their own specificities, for example. So I think that there's lots of space to explore and experiment. And I've seen many, especially artistic and small scale position, not so much like big institutions. They seem to be a bit more, I don't know, scared or maybe a bit slower in terms of trying something new, but especially like a single position artist or a small scale group and collectives of curators. I've seen lots of different experimentations of trying to create new forms of exhibition. I'm thinking of Gallery Delivery by Sebastian Schmig. I'm thinking of Local Host Gallery on Minecraft. I'm thinking of El Paquete Semanal in Cuba, although it's not an exhibition. I mean, many of these new forms of sharing and transferring art and knowledge in different ways are super interesting to explore. And I think it's definitely something that should be done more by institutions if they want to stay relevant.
Okay, thank you for this comprehensive discussion. Maybe Kate has something to tell us.
Yeah, thanks Doris and Marco for this. It's really quite amazing to have your feedback and to talk with our audience and to have this possibility to sharing your knowledge. It's really nice. And also I'd like to say thank you for our audience that you so long to stay with us.